our lawyer's name is Leon Wildes, and he's not a radical lawyer, he's not a William Consul, nothing like that. We went to an immigration lawyer who knew about immigration, and he has really been surprised, because he worked in immigration 15 years, he's really been surprised by some of the things that have gone on.
Richard Nixon felt that if John Lennon was to remain here with his immense influence on young people, that he might lose his re-election campaign. So as a result, he started an immediate deportation proceeding against Lennon.
Further, we submit that the law does not reflect the human equities. It is a law that needs to be changed.
John asked me to publish wherever I could that people could apply for this special benefit that he discovered in this case. And I finally got around to writing the whole book that has just been published.
When I tell him that I'm doing fine, watching shadows on the wall. Don't you miss the big time, boy, you're no longer on the ball. I'm just sitting here watching the wheels go round and round. I really love to watch them roll. No longer riding on the merry-go-round.
I'm the Dean of Cardozo Law School, and I'm thrilled to, oh, thank you. I'm so thrilled to celebrate tonight with you the publication of the book for celebrating this important case. Leon Wildes the spirit of Leon Wildes is typical of the spirit of Cardozo Law School. We've been very lucky to count him as one of our professors for many years. He taught generations of Cardozo students immigration law. And so it's fitting that as we begin our 40th year, this is our 40th year, we're celebrating it and very excited that we should kick off the year with this amazing celebration. The Wildes are a very important family to us. Not only did Leon teach, but his son Michael was a graduate, and now we have Michael's two children who have just joined us as 1L students. So they're sort of a dynasty here. And we're very, very happy. But Mr. Wildes exemplifies the pioneering spirit of Cardozo. It was created by a group of entrepreneurial lawyers who weren't afraid to challenge the status quo. We had one of the first criminal law clinics in the country. We're the home of the Innocence Project, which to date has been responsible for freeing from prison more than 350 wrongly incarcerated people. And Leon planted the seed for what has now grown into a great immigration law program here at Cardozo. And the highlight of that program is a Catherine O. Greenberg Immigration Justice Clinic, where students work both on representing people facing deportation and on working to challenge immigration laws, for instance, those that don't allow someone facing a deportation proceeding to have a lawyer. And so the students really work very hard on challenging unjust immigration policy. So it's just a very fitting to have you here tonight to celebrate this, and we're so pleased to welcome all of you here. So enjoy the evening. Thank you.
My name is Michael Wildes, and it's my honor to welcome everybody. I thank Dean Leslie for her gracious greeting, and for scores of clients, family, friends, and just good countrymen that all came out to pay our respects to a very special man. I do bring regrets from Yoko. Unfortunately, she is not going to be able to join us this evening. She did send us a beautiful note, which seems to have been taken from my clipboard by somebody who wanted my father's phone number. Needless to say, she wrote a very kind note about how important our dad and his work is to her, to Sean, and the legacy and the brilliance of dad's magnanimous work. We thank her not only for her graciousness in letting dad publish the book, but for her extraordinary friendship and love that we've enjoyed now for 45 years. Any media inquiries, anybody that's here should call the Dakota Studio One. And again, we thank the media that are in attendance for their gracious and their very robust handling of this case. Again, a story that needs to be told. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to acknowledge the presence of Dad's wife, Alice, my partner in life, Amy, and our four beautiful children, my brother Mark, Jill, and their children, our law partner, Steve Weinberg, and a smattering of about the 100-plus associate lawyers that have travailed our office for the last 56 years. And of course, my in-laws, Susan and Robert Messer. We'd like to thank the publisher, Anchorwick, the American Bar Association publisher, who recognized when law school enrollment was depleting that cases like this could actually draw more people to the fold, and that this was a story with great depth and actually needed to be told. The critical reviews of the press were really astounding and added to the lexicon. And we could not have an event like this if we didn't have it in this beautiful hall, in this beautiful institution. Cardozo Law School is now celebrating its 40th year. When I was introduced to this school, I was a high school kid following my dad with a briefcase. Some things haven't changed, Dad. And Dad inaugurated what is now a very robust inventory of the immigration portfolio of classes that they have. He did this for 33 years at a time where there was no casebook, there was no class, and right now there is a very strong following. I met my wife in this class. He educated scores of lawyers, jurists, and prosecutors, and I'm proud to have succeeded him now in teaching the course. And yes, there will be two of his grandchildren taking the class, and who knows what will happen in the next generation. I'd like to acknowledge the presence of some very special people that have joined us. First, an icon of media, Geraldo Rivera. Thank you, Geraldo, for joining us with your lovely wife, Erica. Geraldo interviewed John and Yoko, and I'll ask you maybe if you'll just come up for a moment and share a few words.
Hi, everybody. Nice to see you. A packed house. I acknowledge Leon, a wonderful attorney, a landmark case. It was a big part of my my early history. You know, it's so interesting, and Michael, I thank you. You're such a top flight lawyer right now, and guest on our programs on Fox News and elsewhere. Isn't it interesting that immigration has now, in the last couple of weeks, come to be the number one issue in the presidential race? How, whether you're an immigration hardliner or someone more compassionate, and I don't mean to judge one side or the other, is almost how you define which party you're voting for, which candidate you're voting for. And the feelings, if there are bitter feelings toward immigrants, are so visceral. Now cast yourself back to when Leon got this case, back to the administration of Richard Nixon. The country was riven bitterly divided. The Vietnam War was still raging. Richard Nixon had won the election of 68, but in 72 was himself kind of infected with a kind of paranoia and insecurity. And in the context of the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement and everything else comes John and Yoko to New York in 1971. And John obviously overstays the visa, as Michael has described. And the administration, John Mitchell was the Attorney General, and it's hard, I know, for younger people to even think of an entire administration focused on getting one visa overstay out of the country at any cost necessary. In that year, in 1972, John and Yoko graciously agreed to do a concert, two concerts actually, in Madison Square Garden for the charity that I established following the expose of the Willowbrook Institution for the population we then described as mentally retarded. It was an enormous success, and I think really in many ways, in the same way USA versus Lennon is a landmark immigration case, that expose and the subsequent community efforts to close these horrible institutions for the developmentally disabled, that was a pivot in history. And the fact that John and Yoko agreed to do that concert brought enormous attention to the cause. So you had John, the political activist, the anti-war activist, the give peace a chance activist, and you also had John and Yoko, the compassionate, generous artists who gave so much. It was really one of the first of the great benefit concerts. The concert for Bangladesh had been the year earlier, George Harrison, 1971, and here were John and Yoko and Roberta Flack and Shana Nan, Stevie Wonder in Madison Square Garden in 1972. So you had John the compassionate, John the activist, Nixon the, I know history is kind of constantly reassessing him, but there was no doubt the full force of the federal government coming down on John Lennon, this one immigrant, to get him out of the country, to deport him, and hanging their head, and they'll be described far more vividly than I can right now, on this marijuana possession charge from the UK from years earlier, the guilty plea. So where do I come in? Leanne calls me. They had four witnesses. It was Norman Mailer, you'll describe it, Norman Mailer, Gloria Swanson, I think, the Japanese composer, and me. And I testified with Leanne's prodding to what John meant to the population of the developmentally disabled in this country. And just think about it, if the government had succeeded in getting John out prior to our concert, there never would have been a one-to-one concert, maybe the movement never would have caught fire the way it did. He had great social significance aside from the political statements that he was constantly making. So he did that, his last fully rehearsed concert of his life, and they raised, I think, $300,000, which in today's dollars is in the well into the millions of dollars. And I was very proud and pleased to tell the immigration court exactly the difference he had made. But my testimony and all the rest would have amounted to nothing but for the expertise, the skill, the doggedness of Leon Wiles and how he pursued that case, how he took on John Mitchell and the Nixon administration, defied them, helped establish new law, and kept that wonderful artist in our country. And I don't think there's a person, regardless of your political stripe right now, who thinks that America is not better off for John Lennon having been here. Tragically, he was killed here just 5-6 years after the positive verdict, but just 7-8 years after our wonderful concert. So I salute him, Leon, for what he did. I salute you for being here to celebrate his book. Michael, one of the fine practitioners of immigration law now, and look how what was old is new again. Here we are back where we started in many ways, but give peace a chance, everybody.
The note from Yoko, dear Leon, I appreciate our friendship and what you and your family have done for John. It was more than tremendous. Thank you from my heart and from all of our family. Michael, please thank your dad for putting all of our memories in this beautiful book. A big, big smile to your dad and to you. With love, Yoko Ono. Just a gentle request, people up in the left, it's a fire hazard, just clear a path. Thank you. We'd like to also recognize media superstar Rosanna Scotto, who joins us. Thank you, Rosanna. And Bob Gruen. Bob, are you here? Bob, thank you. And that's an iconic photo of John in the t-shirt with the New York City. Thank you, Bob, for these wonderful photos and letting us memorialize your work as well in this piece. To John Willick, who put this deal and this wonderful work together. To, again, Larry Udis, our partner in love and in law, and to a host of other wonderful composers and pianists and conductors that join us today. It's not that I can't pronounce your names, you're all clients of our office, but I don't want to leave somebody out. Also to Marla Hansen, who joins us, an icon in the world of media and culture, to Seth Saltzman from Why Hunger, and some dear friends back in the day from Forest Hills, from Jeff Wiesenfeld to my Aunt Joyce and Uncle Aaron, who join us in friendship and in love. I'd like to, at this point, call upon my brother, Rabbi Mark Wildes, to say a few words. The book is dedicated to the memory of our mother and to John Lennon, and we have an annual memorial, and we decided to consolidate both events. A word of Torah is always appreciated.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for being here. It's a very special night for our family, as Michael mentioned. First of all, the launch of this long-awaited book that of my father's extraordinary representation of John and Yoko. And as my brother mentioned, it's also the 21st memorial event in memory of our mother, Ruth Wildes, Aleha Shalom, a blessed memory. And I was thinking about this. The connection is really very powerful because I can't think of a more appropriate way of bringing honor to my mother's memory than by having this book warming tonight. It's incredible what I can do when I speak. My father, as my brother mentioned, dedicated this book to my mother and to John, and it was so appropriate that he did so to both of them, because the kind of family person our mother was turned out actually to be a huge part of the relationship that my parents enjoyed with the Lennons. See, in the years that my dad represented John and Yoko, John decided to take a little respite from his world of music. He took a break to become more of a family man, to be a better husband, and to learn how to become a father. But the people that John and Yoko surrounded themselves with were primarily artists and musicians, not exactly family-oriented people. And then they met my parents, and specifically my mother. She was a huge Beatles fan. She had heard of the Beatles, unlike my father, who actually never heard of him when we first met him. We'll hear that later, it's true. But besides being one of the screaming young women in 1964 when they came to these shores, what my mother truly valued in her life was her role as a wife and as a mother. She was a very giving person by nature, and that was something that Yoko and John admired and wanted to learn from when they were starting to create their own family. And I believe that that love for family stemmed largely from her traditional Jewish upbringing, which many of us here know emphasizes so heavily marriage and family. In fact, in this week's coming Torah portion, in Parshat Shoftim, the Torah tells us that there are three individuals, three of the people who are exempt from military service. The Bible lists these three types: Mi'aish Asherbana Bayit Chadash, a man who has just built a new home, V'lo Chanacho, but has not yet moved in. U'Mi'aish Asher Natak Kerem, or a person who plants a vineyard, V'lo chilalu, but has not yet enjoyed its fruit. U'mi'ayish asher eras isha, or a man who becomes engaged to a woman, v'lo lekacha, but has not yet become married. And if you look at the common denominator of these three exemptions, they all revolve around the family. The home is at the center, because even more important than the synagogue or the academy of study, the yeshiva, the Jewish home sits at the center and is considered the most important institution of Jewish life. And it was the most important thing to our mother. Nothing was more significant to her, and she wanted us, her family, to have it all. And I'll just end with one anecdote. When John and Yoko's beautiful boy, as he said, their son Sean, was born, my father wanted to buy something special for him. And so he arranged with another client, who was a huge Beatles fan, and said he would do it for nothing, for John and Yoko, that he would create a child's chair carved from wood with Sean's name on it. And when the sample was sent to our home and my mother got a glimpse of it, she said to my father, "It's very nice. Well, what about your children? They're special too? Shouldn't they have a chair with their name on it?" So my brother and I both got a chair with our name on it, engraved into the wood, which sits in my living room and my brother's living room. She always thought about her family first, and that was the kind of home she built. But it was a home that was not only focused on us, her family. It was a place for those on the outside. Virtually every Shabbat, she hosted newcomers from the community. She used the motion to my brother in synagogue when she saw that somebody new was coming in. Go invite him for Shabbat, for lunch. She wasn't an immigration lawyer like my dad, but she did a pretty good job welcoming in the stranger and making people from other places feel very, very comfortable and welcome in our home. And so that's why we established MJE, the Manhattan Jewish Experience, in her memory, to perpetuate the loving kindness that she showed to those on the outside. And this year we're celebrating 18, which is a very important number in Jewish tradition. 18 years, our talented staff, all of whom are here this evening, we have reached out and attracted tens of thousands of our less affiliated Jewish brothers and sisters, bringing them into our Shabbat dinners, our weeknight classes, our weekend retreats, our trips to Israel, following the example of our mother, who made everyone feel at home in our community. And so I thank you all for being here tonight, for showing honor to our mother's memory, and for paying tribute to my father, whose life legacy in the field of immigration law is truly inspirational and something very, very important that we can all learn something from. Thank you and good evening.
Thank you, Mark. John respected our Shabbos, would call and ask in a high-pitched voice if it was over, because he knew he couldn't call us. You can honor John, Yoko, and my brother's work. There are envelopes and information out front. He does beautiful work. This is not a fundraiser, but I'm very proud of my kid brother, and he's really done an extraordinary job in perpetuating our mom's legacy as well. I would like to recognize Rabbi Shmuley Boteach and a few other luminaries in our community, but I'm going to stop because I will offend people that I can't see. 5 years after John Lennon was killed, I sat at my grandfather's funeral when my father compared his father to a compass, a little instrument that capably steered a tonnage of a ship, a massive ship, with very precious cargo on it. I didn't truly understand the analogy. I was young. But I realize now that I still, and I do, revere my father in the same way he spoke of his. Dad would often talk of his father's decency and character. He once told us of his father who walked miles just to return a customer's change that he had given improperly. A lot of these anecdotes are in the foreword to the book. My father took on every case, figuring out a way to be an advocate for those who couldn't advocate for themselves. And if you speak to our partner, Steve Weinberg, Steve, where are you? Thank you. Steve never heard the word no. never heard, we can't. The law doesn't allow it. Let's file it. Let's get it in. The tenacity, the bravery, made the law. You could never tell who Dad was talking to on the telephone, a rock star or a housekeeper. It didn't matter what station in life, what the person did, it was the content of their character. We had the privilege, my brother and I, to see him develop into an extraordinary lawyer with robust relationships, garnering great academic respect and displaying true acts of character in little daily events. His life imbued with this beautiful blend that this institution stands for, a man of faith and a true professional with great legal skills and standards. However, ladies and gentlemen, the one thing that stands out to this day at 83 years young is his humility. It is just extraordinary. It is, in of itself, iconic. Dad would take a dictaphone on every holiday vacation we had for the last 45 years and belt out a chapter in this book. Poised with an even greater tenacity, character, intellect, and an unfaltering diligence, he put together this work that you see before you. Each case in our firm gave him energy when he needed it and inspired scores of lawyers, adversaries, and government officials for his scholarship and expertise. Let's go back to 1972. It feels like ancient history and before many people here were born. It was the year that The Godfather won the Best Motion Picture. The US Airlines began mandatory inspection of passengers and baggage. The 26th Amendment had newly enfranchised 18 to 20-year-olds. And Give Peace a Chance was the national anthem for anti-war activists. Richard Nixon that year perpetrated the Watergate activities, ultimately causing him to resign and avoid prosecution. Who would have known, ladies and gentlemen, that 40 years later, the case we are here to discuss would be relied upon by another president of the United States to defer the deportation of over 700,000 Dreamers, children who were born on U.S. soil by no act, no other grace of God other than their parents who brought them here, and the scores of people that turned to this prosecutorial discretion as a remedy before our courts. Dad uncovered the secret program in this case by using the Freedom of Information Act in a provocative way, and it was used by thousands who learned its governing principles and assembled it to help unify families for generations. In 1976, this case opened America's doors for John and Yoko. In 2012, it provided President Obama with a legal basis to protect hundreds of thousands of immigrants. Dad, you described your father as a compass. You too have been a guiding light for me, for my family, and for the lives of millions of families throughout our nation who have benefited from your extraordinary work. I cannot be any prouder than I am of you today, and I wanted you to hear this from Mark and I. Let's have a conversation with Leon Wildes, the author of this important work. I'd like to ask Rosanna, who's more skilled at this, to join us. And we're going to hear from yet another talented client of ours, Alfio Bonanno, after we complete the interview. Thank you. Okay, guys, thanks for your patience. And this is feeding into two or three other classrooms upstairs. So thank you for your patience on the screen as well. Okay, Dad, you're just a slow writer. Why did you choose to get this out finally now?
That's essentially it. I think I'm just a slow writer. And vacation after vacation. Sometimes I miss a vacation, but generally I would take my little dictating machine along and a piece of the file, which fills about three huge drawers, and work on the case. It was only in the last few years that I simply had to focus on it more and spend more time with it, that I actually withdrew from teaching at this wonderful institution and decided to do it very seriously. It wasn't an easy task. You pointed out already that I wasn't a very astute pop music artist or wasn't very knowledgeable about the Beatles and so on. But it was a labor of love, and I had an enormous respect for John Lennon and for Yoko Ono, which hasn't left me.
I have to say, I got a chance to interview Michael and Leon on Good Day New York. And Leon, you told a very, very funny story about how you met Yoko and John, and then you went home and told your wife. And I'd love for you to share that experience with everybody.
I was invited by Alan Klein, the manager of the Beatles at one point, and he certainly John Lennon's manager at the time, to accompany him and a lawyer in his employ to visit a new client. And on our way there, the young lawyer, who had been a classmate of mine a number of years earlier, said to me, I said, "Who are these people?" He said, "John Lennon and Yoko Ono." I said, "Who are these people?" he said, "You don't know who John Lennon is?" I said, "No." He said, "Don't ever admit that."
But what did you tell your wife when you went home?
When I went home, my late wife said to me, "Leon, why your office called and said that you wouldn't be home for dinner and that you were to meet potential new clients who were heavyweights. Who were they?" I said, "Well, it was Jack Lemmon and Yoko Moto." I think I believed that that he was a musician with the Bugs or something. Forgive me, I was into opera at the time, and I skipped that entire part of my education.
Rosanna, he went the next day back to see John and Yoko and was embarrassed to come home, so what did you do?
Yeah, on the way back home, after I met them the second time, I took a cab. And the cab driver, a young man with long hair, which was, of course, significant at the time. All the young people looked like that. So there were very few people like me with haircuts. I asked the cab driver, "Who is John Lennon?" I figured I'd get a young man's explanation. He said, "John Lennon is the greatest musician who ever lived." Oh, I said, "That's kind of a big claim. I'm sure there were other musicians." He said, "Who do you think would be the greatest musician who ever lived?" Oh, I said, "Of course, Ludwig von Beethoven."
Meter's running, by the
way. Actually, I stopped him in front of our house and I said, "Let the meter run because I want to hear from you. Why do you think he's the greatest musician who ever lived?" He said, "Well, Beethoven might have had a couple of 100,000 people over the years know about him, but John Lennon is an unbelievable thing that has kept. We're just very lucky that it's in our time, but it will be forever."
Sure.
I said, what do you know about music? Where did you learn this?" He said, "I'm a music major at Queens College." And I guess I realized then who I was representing.
Huh. What was John like? I mean, you spent a lot of time with him. What kind of person was he, and did you understand him at first? Because he had a very thick Cockney accent, right?
I had no difficulty in understanding him. He was the guy who, when we first met, listened carefully while Yoko asked a lot of questions and started brewing tea. He was the guy who later on was so concerned and thoughtful about the fact that, and so considerate, that I didn't answer the phone on Friday night and Saturday for religious reasons, and he would never violate that rule. Michael might remember that we were in Grossinger's once for the high holidays, and I had just finished getting my two boys together. They were young, and we were going to go downstairs to the services, and the phone rang. The woman on the phone said, the operator said, "There's some wise guy on the phone who claims he's John Lennon. He has to speak to you before Yontif." That means holiday. He was very, very special, imaginative. The first time we went to a hearing, I was concerned that although my clients had been on stages for years, that they might be very nervous in a courtroom being deported from the United States, because the government was so out to get them, that I called my friend Vincent Chiano, who was the chief trial attorney for the government. I said, "I know, Vinny," I said, "that you are a Beatles fan. Suppose I come to the office an hour early. We'll avoid crowds downstairs in the Immigration Service before the hearing. And suppose we actually just talk about music or whatever you would like to talk about so that they feel at home." He said, "Leon, I'd be happy to do that." And so there I am. The hearing is to start at about 9 o'clock. We're there at 8. We had the most delightful conversation. Vinny had brought one of his children with him, who also was a big Lennon fan. But then as we're almost ready to go into the hearing, Vinny calls me aside and says, "Leon, I don't think you've told him that I'm the prosecutor." You know, they may not think I'm a nice guy because I know their music, but so I said, "John, Vinny here is the government's prosecuting attorney." And immediately, Lennon dropped to the floor at Chiano's feet, started he whipped out a handkerchief from his pocket and started shining his shoes. He said, "Is there anything else I can do for you, Mr. Chiano?" With that, we walked into the Immigration Judge's courtroom.
It was there were surreal scenes where there were icons. Andy Warhol. Who did you go to Serendipities with once then?
Jack Nicholson was one of the. We would bring along a whole slew of witnesses every time we had a case that required it or where I could encourage it. And Jack Nicholson, somehow we didn't get to him. The judge had heard all the witnesses he was willing to hear. So as we left the place, John says to Yoko, "Do you mind, we're going to Serendipity for ice cream." And he said, would you mind if we bring Jack Nicholson along? And Jack Nicholson came along.
You knew who he was?
I got the general idea. When I have to prepare a witness, I really study who he is.
Tell us why they wanted to deport John Lennon. What did President Nixon and the INS have against him?
Well, first of all, the president is a politician and he wants to be reelected. 1972, I was retained in, I think, January of 72. And that year was his election because of the passage of the 26th Amendment. The voting age was reduced from 21 to 18. Richard Nixon was sending anybody during those ages to Vietnam. We had already lost 50,000 soldiers in Vietnam. It seemed to be an endless fight. And it was really sad. And it was clear that the younger generation was growing up hating the administration. So that the first answer is that he was afraid he might not be reelected. We estimated that there might be 5 million new voters. Nobody was clear on the figures at the time. And then President Nixon had with him an Attorney General,
John Mitchell.
John Mitchell had, he wore two hats. He was the Attorney General in charge of the Immigration Service, the FBI, the Federal Judiciary Service, everything in law enforcement. His other hat was as the head of CREEP, the Committee to Re-elect the President. Now, I don't know which hat he was wearing when he got this letter from Senator Strom Thurmond. The letter enclosed a memorandum showing the history of what was going on with respect to John Lennon. They were convinced that the youth in the United States would rise up against the administration and vote them out of office. And they were also convinced that John Lennon was the person who was capable of leading them. It was pretty obvious. So what happened here is you have a situation with the election of the president, which is coming on, and the part of the memo that he had was, this was from the Senate Internal Security Committee. I was pretty convinced when I first heard of it that it was abandoned in the 1950s when we stopped chasing Russians. And they said right in there that it would be smart, since he is here, since the Lennons are here as visitors, to simply cut them short and let them get them out of the United States, or we're going to have a trouble with the whole young community.
So the President of the United States was very upset, and he thought that John Lennon was going to basically rile up the youth and vote against him.
Yes.
At that time. So Michael mentioned earlier that President Obama used whatever precedent you put into place in 2012. Now immigration has become, once again, a very big issue in this race. Do you think it's similar circumstances, and will what you put in place still hold up?
Well, what I put in place resulted in high court decisions, and it will hold up. The president and the enforcement in the United States, that arm of government, has the authority to determine who they can who they need to deport and who they will allow to remain. The since I started practicing law, I had heard that there were cases of people who were completely deportable and were still around the United States. When they arrested the Lennons and brought them in, they essentially said to the public, particularly the district director in the New York Office of Immigration, they said to the public, we have no choice. Anytime we find an illegal alien, we must remove him. We're not treating Lennon any different from anybody else. And that wasn't true. So several years into the litigation that I had in the case, I brought a further lawsuit under the Freedom of Information Act, and I asked for the documents relating to the non-priority program. That's what we all called it in legal circles. They slowed me up for about a year until they actually delivered to me a box of records, duly changed. They removed all the names and identifying information and so on. But there were 1,843 cases of people who were seriously deportable from the United States who were allowed to remain here. And when that box of records came to the office, there was jubilation in my office. And John asked me to analyze those cases and let others know. He was very concerned about that. He didn't feel that he was the only one being threatened. And that resulted in 5 full law review articles with hundreds of footnotes and so on. Now that program worked. Like Michael said before, there were some 600,000 young people who were brought to the United States under the age of 16. They didn't know any other country. They didn't speak any other language. They were here. So what President Obama did was he gave them an almost status. Without Congress, he couldn't give them a status, but he made it possible for them to get driver's licenses, school, social security cards, ID, a lot of stuff like that. I received a call from my son Mark's former rabbinic school professor from Israel, and he said to me, he said, Mr. Wildes, my best student here is visiting from the United States and he's undocumented in the United States. And then they were allowed to travel after a while as well. He rehabilitated 700,000 to 800,000 young people like that. Now he chose a bigger challenge by trying to get 4 or 5 million people covered when he tried a bigger program. And that bigger program was challenged in the courts in Texas, and the federal courts held that he cannot continue with it. And he brought it to the Supreme Court because I believe that the decision should be the other way and that he does have that authority. But the Supreme Court, unfortunately, split on it 4-4. And of course, the president has not been given the cooperation of Congress to even appoint a final, a ninth justice, so that justice could be done in that case. Now, the reason that this book gets done at this time is because I feel that Congress has not acted. And that's why the president acted in this way, because Congress didn't do its job. Throughout his entire term in office, almost 8 years now, the committees on immigration have not solved a single problem. They haven't done anything to correct the unfortunate situation that our law is behind times. It takes you many years to get a relative sponsored to the United States, no matter all the whole world would like to have them here. It is, unfortunately, a situation, and I think that's ultimately the reason why I pressed, finally, I'm such a slow writer, why I pressed to get this job done.
Well, it's a great book. Did you buy a book tonight? Because it's fascinating. I want to know a little bit about Yoko. I obviously, you still have a good relationship with Yoko. She wrote a very nice note for you tonight.
She has been a constant friend, a continuous friend. I'm still her immigration lawyer, although she has renewed her green card in 10-year intervals, I think 6 times.
Wait, she's not a citizen?
Off the record.
We don't want to get involved.
Breaking news. Wait a second. I got to call this in.
Japan has a special rule. You cannot be a dual citizenship if you're Japanese. And so if she wants to visit her family in Japan, she cannot get American citizenship. She would lose her Japanese citizenship.
So we get to have breakfast with her every decade.
That's pretty cool.
We were just there recently. The government has been very nice as well. They sent an official to take her fingerprints and take photographs and so on, so that she didn't have to go in to the office to do it. They're very respectful and careful with respect to her.
Dad bought his first pair of dungarees, which he still calls them, in the middle of the case. Got all the albums and started playing music a few years behind.
Did he grow his hair longer too?
That's inadvertent if you ask his wife. But he became very familiar with the culture. Do you have a favorite song, Dad?
Well, I have to tell you that a client actually called me, and when I answered the phone, he said, Mr. Wildes, would you mind hanging up a little, because I really appreciate the music you have on your hold. And it's Imagine.
Any other songs?
There is one other song that's very important to me, and that's Beautiful Boy. When I got a call from the clerk of the Court of Appeals, he said, Mr. Wildes, I really shouldn't be doing this, but I have to tell you, I have a decision here in the case of your client, John Lennon, and you won your case. He said, if you would like to send somebody over for it, and you promise not to publish it, because one of the judges may want to come in and touch it up still, I'll let you have it. I called John. He answered the phone in a high-pitched, feminine sounding voice that he always used because we were being tapped. And I said, John, it's Leon calling. We've won the case. He said, listen, you have to explain. I always had to explain it to Yoko. He said, you have to explain this to Yoko. And she's in New York Hospital now. She's expecting to give birth tonight or tomorrow morning. So he said, suppose you stay at your desk and I'll call you when I get there. He called from there and they invited me to come over and to bring Ruth, my late wife. We went over and I had the decision by then. And we sat for at least an hour, Yoko and I, reviewing the entire decision.
There's she was not in any pain during that?
I'll tell you what happened. She got to be very uncomfortable, and my wife said to me, Leon, we have to leave. And then John came and said, can I tell him now? Can I tell him now? He asked Yoko. She said, okay, tell him, tell him. He said, Leon, you're the only lawyer I understand, and my wife loves you, but
I want to tell you why we chose you.
But, you know, we're very happy with your representation, and you've really done a great job, but Yoko, but can I tell him now why he continued? Yes. So he said, Yoko's tarot card readers said, keep Leon, he's gonna win the case. So what does a religious Jew say to that? He said, God bless tarot card readers.
Tell them. All right, so Yoko's uncomfortable, mom skedaddles with dad. What happens through the evening?
I get a call very early in the morning. I was still sleeping. And he said, it's John. I said, John who? He said, John Lennon, and I have a beautiful boy.
Aww.
So that's how I heard about Beautiful Boy, and I love that song.
That was a special day, Dad.
It was his birthday, it was his son's birthday, and he won his case.
Wow.
My dad, that there are several film deals. Thank you, Merrill Moss, one of the best PR for book industry. In the making, who should play you in a feature film? There have been a few documentaries. He's got to write it.
He's
been researching it.
Check out who I wanted. I understand that Paul Newman has passed away.
That would be long distance. Who else?
They tell me that Robert Redford and George Clooney are still around.
Okay. Mr. Yudis did some work for George Clooney, right? In this great place of scholarship, where you taught this case for 33 years, you still continue in the last six that I'm teaching to add scholarship to that class. And you have two of your grandchildren, Raquel and Josh, already embarking in their law careers. What advice do you have for prospective law students and jurists? Go to medical school?
Well, I would tell them to devote themselves. If they want to be lawyers, devote themselves to the work. The American Bar Association is the company that has a publication house that chose to publish this book. And I've heard recently that the enrollment in law schools has dropped off in the past 10 years. Now that means that young people intending in the law or young law students feel there's something that they're missing. Essentially, that is that they may not get the gratification that doing one lawyer's work for one client gives you. All I can tell you is that this book, I think, is an example of one lawyer's work, and it was one client, and I feel that something very special was accomplished, and it makes me feel very, very happy. And my only recommendation to you is don't give up on it. Find an area of the law that gives you the satisfaction that you would like to have in life.